It's UofL Today on 93.9 The Ville. Here's your host, Mark Hebert.
Welcome to UofL Today with Mark Hebert on 93.9 The Ville. If you're looking for talk about good things going on at the University of Louisville, you've found the right place because that's what this show is all about the research, the students, and the faculty and staff at the University of Louisville. On the show today, UofL School of Public Health has a couple of new degree programs in health administration and data analytics, and we'll have some folks here to tell you about those, and a study of how alcohol plays a role in teenagers with bulimia or other eating disorders. We'll have a researcher from UofL's Eating Disorders Clinic on with us to talk about that. But first, have you taken out a life insurance policy lately? Did you know that the insurance company can get your medical records and get results of any genetic testing you may have had? Well, Mark Rothstein is the director of the Institute for Bioethics, Health Policy, and Law at the University of Louisville, and he looks at these ethical questions in healthcare and is here to discuss his view on genetic testing and life insurance policies. Mark, welcome back. Good to see you.
Good to see you.
Genetic testing and life insurance. So what can life insurance companies do right now? If I go try to get a policy, what can they find on me?
Well, they can do more than they actually do. In virtually every state, that they could require that you undergo a genetic test and then use the results to calculate your risk and whether they're going to insure you and even the rates. But they're not doing that. No insurance company in the United States is currently doing that. What they do is require access to your medical records, and then they would see in your medical records any information from genetic tests that were ordered by your doctor. The problem that is arising now is that many people are getting tested what it's called off record. So you can do with a direct-to-consumer company like 23andMe, you get the results. The life insurance company doesn't get the results. About 15 million people.
Well, that's good, isn't it?
Well, only
maybe
for the time being.
Okay.
Because so far about 15 million people have done this. What happens when the number is 25 or 30 or 50? Insurance companies are worried about what's called adverse selection. That is the tendency of people who know they need insurance to get insurance.
And right, they don't want to cover those folks because they may die early or they may have some disease or whatever, right?
Exactly right. But they don't know who they are, but the individuals know who they are. And to protect themselves, life insurance companies are going to have to do one of two things. They're going to have to either do their own testing or say, we don't care what test results people have. We are not going to get access to them or use the results of genetic tests run in the clinical setting, which we normally would get access to, or that individuals get on their own.
But right now, again, going back to my example, if I want to buy a life insurance policy, a life insurance company can go get my health records, right? Which may include
with your consent.
With my
of course,
consent.
Yeah.
Well, of course. But they're not going to give me a policy if I don't consent, right?
Exactly.
So I got to consent if I want to get the life insurance policy. So they can get that. And if it includes some sort of genetic testing that I may have had done in the hospital way back when, just to see, you know, if I'm susceptible to heart disease or something in the future, they can get that, right? They
right.
can, but
yes.
they're not. But most no, life insurance.
They're not doing their own testing.
They're not doing their own, but they are getting it from guys like me, right?
Correct.
Okay. So what do they do with that?
Well, the information may have very important risk factors in there.
Like I'm susceptible to heart disease.
Well, or maybe
or
something
whatever.
That's even more predictive, like you're likely to get Lou Gehrig's disease or
Parkinson's,
Huntington's disease,
something like that.
Something like
yeah,
that
okay.
At a younger age, and it has, you know, in many cases, no treatment, and they're not going to insure you at all.
Okay. So that's the problem, right?
That's
part of
the problem.
Okay. What's the rest of the problem?
The rest of the problem is that there are many people in the U.S., as elsewhere, that have a family history of very serious illness, and they would benefit by having genetic testing done by their doctors so they could evaluate the risk and in some cases actually take some measures to prevent those risks from coming about. And there are many genetic related cancers that would be a good example. Well, these people are dissuaded from undergoing testing because not only can life insurance get information that way through the results, but long-term care insurance companies and all sorts of other insurance products And we know that a lot of people are not getting genetic testing who would benefit from it. And my concern is that we're missing the opportunity to save lives by worrying about sort of the economic consequences, and we need to figure out a way that that's going to not happen.
Talking with Mark Rothstein, who is the director of the Institute for Bioethics, Health Policy, and Law at the University of Louisville. So from your view, what should we do?
Well,
or what should government do?
It's interesting. Many other countries have acted in this area. We're slow to act. Canada just enacted a law last year. There have been laws in England for the last decade or more. Australia is thinking of doing something. What I am recommending is that if the life insurance companies don't voluntarily say, we are not going to use the results of genetic test results, then the government should prohibit them from doing that. That's not to say they can't use any genetic information that might be in your record, or family history that might be in the record. If you take that out, we've destroyed the entire industry, and a lot of people need life insurance. What I'm suggesting is sort of a middle ground, not using those genetic test results. Then people would not feel, you know, I can't do this because I'm going to lose all sorts of prospects. And I actually don't think that life insurance companies in particular need the specific test results.
Why not? Well, if I were a life insurance company, I'd want them, right? Because then you could determine, oh, well, Mark Rothstein, he's got some genetic makeup that he's predisposed to get Parkinson's or something. But Mark Hebert over here, I don't see anything in his background. We'll insure him, but we're not going to give a policy to that Rothstein guy.
Well, think about the kinds of cases in which genetic test information would not be available by other means. If they're getting your family history, then they would know whether someone in your family had this. This would be sort of a red flag for them, and they would follow up on it. If you're applying for life insurance in an amount that's unrelated to your income, they might think, well, maybe Mr. Hebert has a reason for doing that and inquire further. And if you're going to get a genetic disease, many of them would manifest before you would apply for insurance. So the number of conditions that would sort of spring up suddenly are relatively few. And life insurance companies, if they thought about it, they would realize that, and maybe they would change their procedures.
Right. And right now, you can't discriminate against folks who are trying to get health insurance policies, right?
Right. There's a federal law that prohibits genetic discrimination in employment and health insurance, but it doesn't extend to disability insurance, long-term care insurance, life insurance, or other products.
So might your view on this genetic testing and the ability of life insurance companies to get hold of that information and use it, might that also extend to these other insurance?
I think it would, but life insurance is the huge gorilla in the room.
Right.
We buy in the United States about 11 million policies a year, whereas in long-term care policies, it's about 100,000, and disability insurance, it's about 500,000. So the big guys, once we get them in line, then we can deal with the others.
And you've been digging on this whole ethical question of genetic testing and other things. What are some of the other areas that you're looking at right now?
Well, one of the things that I'm looking at is the use of genetic information in real estate transactions. People haven't looked at that yet, and it hasn't been used yet, but there's no legal reason why it couldn't. So if you're a mortgage company, do you want to give me a 30-year mortgage when I'm not going to be around in 10 years? If you can get that information legally and easily and cheaply, why wouldn't you do that? And there are all sorts of other situations where any entity that has a sort of a financial interest in your future health, if they can get that information and legally use it, they'll do it.
Is there a danger of that actually happening, you think?
Absolutely.
Is it happening now?
It's not happening now. Whenever I discover these new areas, I am of mixed views, right? Because I don't want to call it to the attention of people who hadn't thought of it, but it's going to be thought of by everybody anyhow, so I might as well get my views out.
Isn't that the same as redlining or similar?
Well, it's similar in certain respects. And until World War II, we allowed life insurance companies to discriminate on the basis of race and have two different sets of tables that were used. And we allowed redlining for insurance and mortgages and stuff until the 60s. So this is another area where time is right for us to act.
UofL School of Public Health is a hot commodity these days as more and more jobs open up in public health fields. Doctors Leigh Bewley and Chris Johnson are with the School of Public Health and Information Sciences. They're here to talk about what's hot and a couple new degree programs. Welcome, gentlemen.
Well, thank you.
Thank you.
Good to see you. Glad you're here. All right, you got some new stuff going on in public health, right? New programs?
Yeah, so we've opened a number of new programs, one of which has started this fall, and one is going to start fall of 19, and one is a Master of Science in Health Administration program, which is designed to educate people who are going to be leaders in healthcare organizations, from free clinics to insurance companies to entrepreneurial technology companies to your traditional healthcare systems. These students are being trained to work within those environments and to particularly in the current environment of trying to find value in the money that particularly the state and federal government pays for these products.
Making the dollars go farther.
Right. Right.
The limited dollars in the federal government.
Right.
All right. And the second, that one starts.
That's already online.
That's already online. All right.
We're admitting students in that one. And then the Master of Science in Health Data Analytics is a brand new degree that opens in the fall, and it will admit its first class in the fall. And that is in response to a lot of employers' demands to have employees that can actually do the kind of health data analytics that you're required to do in 2018, whether or not it's doing advanced data mining of healthcare, whether or not it's getting data from sensors. One pharmaceutical company has a pin that you can stick to get your insulin, and they want to be able to transmit data to about the person that they're sticking. And so these students are going to be trained to take data like that and do analysis. And there's a lot of demand for this skill set right now.
The drive of both of these graduate programs are to create master practitioners in two particular fields that are intended to effectively and efficiently utilize our resources. So our MSHA graduates are expected to be leaders in an organizational setting to control costs, to be able to identify those areas where there's the most cost-effective application of basic healthcare delivery. The healthcare data analytics folks, those graduates will be intended to look at massive data. We have so much data across the world, the old thinking of water everywhere, none to help us drink. But how about data everywhere and none to help us think? These practitioners of health data analytics can, one, manage that data in a way that is consistent with law and requirements and ethical considerations, but also to make actionable intelligence so that we can make informed decisions to minimize waste and to extend the precious resources that we have that will enhance the public health.
And that's a really big burgeoning field, isn't it? Data in healthcare. It's gotten to be huge because people are trying to figure out, all right, what are all these numbers and data? What does it all mean, and how can it help public health, right?
And that it is in Louisville. Our community and our institution specifically have an opportunity to be national leaders. From our healthcare organizations that are either headquartered here on a national basis or our regional players, coupled with the startups and venture capital, we can provide a basis to develop those teammates, those folks that will be human capital that can join the respective teams and to make a difference. Long-term care specifically, the University of Louisville, our graduate programs that span the entire health field, this new healthcare data analytics and the MSHA program, coupled with our partners in the community, can make UofL a great place for personal investment for folks that are seeking this development, but also for our community partners as well.
Talk to Drs. Leigh Bewley and Chris Johnson from the School of Public Health and Information Sciences at the University of Louisville. And who should apply for these? What do I want to be if I want to go through one of these degree programs?
Well, I think that it's interesting when I interview students and talk to them about the programs, same question comes up. And because in healthcare is unique in the sense that a master's degree is really the entry-level degree for a management position. And so we take students from all kinds of backgrounds. One of my best students had a French literature undergraduate degree. And what I tell the students is that, there are different parts, there are going to be different challenges depending on what you're undergraduate degree is. So if you're a business undergraduate, you're probably going to have an easy time in the accounting courses. But when we get to managerial epidemiology and those kinds of courses, which will be new, they'll struggle a little bit. So there really isn't a list of key things to tick off when you think about right. who should come into the program. What all of them have in common, though, is that they want to work in the healthcare industry in some way, shape, or form. Right.
Well, I think it's a heart and a head type of question. The heart part, if you want to make a meaningful difference in our society, and often this is the calling of folks that want to be nurses or doctors, physicians, or allied health professionals. If you want to make a difference, but you want not to focus on a clinical perspective, but on an administration, a policy, a management perspective, come to these programs. Then there's the head perspective. The compensation levels for folks who work in management and health organizations are fairly substantial and provide the ability to provide for yourself and your family in a way that is career enhancing.
Well, let's broaden this topic a little bit and talk about what are the hot careers, the things right now that there just aren't enough of in public health. What are the jobs out there that people are coming to the University of Louisville School of Public Health and saying, I want to be a blank because that's a growing field and I'm really interested in that. What is it? What are those things?
Well, I'll start. One of the areas that we're always struggling with and the reason why we created the Health Data Analytics Program is that data and research are a big part of our field. And so, you know, epidemiologists and biostatisticians are always in demand, and so that's a big field. We actually just opened a brand new Master of Science in Biostatistics that's offered online and in person. So we've been very successful recruiting students in that line. So it's you know, with the opioid crisis, with all the different sort of public health things that are going on, whether or not it's the outbreak of various diseases. Where our graduates are in demand and they're being employed in good paying jobs. And so and I tell the students when they first come into the program, I say, you're here, a lot of times students come in and say, I'm here to, solve the world's problems. I said, no, you're here to get a job. So let's figure out how we're going to get you a job when you finish the program.
I see it's across the spectrum. On one end, we have the folks that are the master practitioners. Our own MSHA program had 16 students that when we opened the program for initial matriculants, and that is noteworthy because our ability to market and promote started in late spring, and then matriculants into the new program were 16. The other end is potentially in the case of adult learners and folks that are returning to education. One, we have our collaboration with the College of Education Human Development for a CBE program in healthcare leadership for folks to be able to complete their degrees to be entry-level managers and administrators. But then within the University of Louisville, one of the primary areas of growth is a bachelor's degree in public health, and we have double-digit increases in enrollments in that sector.
Yeah, I knew the enrollment was way up in that again because everybody talks about these things going on in the world, these viruses and all these outbreaks that are going on. I think students are really interested in that kind of stuff and dealing with the statistics on those kinds of things. So one more question that we got to get out of here. What are the strategic goals? What are the strategic goals for these two new programs that you're starting and all your programs at public health? What do you want them to be?
Well, a lot of people don't realize this, but Louisville is one of the largest concentrations of healthcare organizations in the United States. And so we're in a unique opportunity to produce the leaders who are going to have a great impact on healthcare because we have a lot of national headquarters here. We have a lot of health systems here. And our real goal for these programs is that we're graduating folks that can go into healthcare organizations and help them adjust to the new way of doing business in 2018 because healthcare has changed dramatically since the Affordable Care Act was passed, and we continue to deal with those changes right now.
So I see a couple of practical applications, particularly for our Master's in Science Health Administration program. Currently, we're in candidate phase for national accreditation of our MSHA program through the Commission on Accreditation of Healthcare Management Education. That accreditation visit is this fall. Our expectations are to be nationally accredited this year. We will continue to develop the program. We want to expand enrollments, those 16 matriculants. When we look to the future, we see in the neighborhood of 18 to 25 top-tier students coming in. We want to be nationally ranked a top-tier program in healthcare management in our country within the next 5 years. And that's manifest on one, being able to be accredited, two, having the enrollment of top-tier students, and then three, getting our folks out there in great positions of opportunity to demonstrate the development that they've received here at the University of Louisville can improve the health in their communities.
Well, good luck expanding the high ranking of the programs at the University of Louisville and School of Public Health. Thanks for being on the show. That is Leigh Bewley and Chris Johnson, doctors both at the School of Public Health and Information Sciences at the University of Louisville. Leigh Brosof is no stranger to this program. She works at the Eating Anxiety Treatment Lab at the University of Louisville and is doing research on eating disorders. And today we're talking about twin teenagers, alcohol, body image,
mm-hmm.
right?
Yep, absolutely.
Have I got those things right, Leigh?
You got those things right.
All right.
Yep.
Well, tell us a little bit about this the study you worked on involving twins.
Yeah, so this research was done in collaboration with UNC Chapel Hill at their Center of Eating Disorders for Excellence. And the first author was Dr. Jessica Baker. And so what we did together is we looked at genetic overlap between alcohol use and eating disorder symptoms. And so what that does is it looks at the genetics of what is actually going on in this overlap. So we see overlap between alcohol use and eating disorders a lot. But people really have only looked at it in certain symptoms. So most of the time it's been looked at in bulimic symptoms. So that's when people binge eat and then they use what we call inappropriate compensatory behaviors. So things like vomiting, laxative use, but we really didn't know about other symptoms that people have. And there's a lot of other symptoms in eating disorders like body dissatisfaction, wanting to be thin. So what we did is we said, we know that this relationship exists for some symptoms, but not all symptoms. And so we looked at that in both boys and girls.
All right. But you had to do it with a boy and a girl that mm-hmm. were twins
that were,
to figure
that
out
were
what,
twins.
The, what the genes mm-hmm. had to do with anything, right?
Exactly.
Okay. So what'd you find?
So we found that in boys, it seems to be this really specific relationship.
Between what and what?
Between alcohol use and the bulimic symptoms. So it's specific to bulimic symptoms. So the binge eating and the compensatory behaviors. But in girls, it seems to be there's a generalized relationship between alcohol use and any eating disorder symptom. So what it says is that if girls have any eating disorder symptom, they're really at this generalized risk for also having alcohol use overlap. For boys, we really only see that overlap with bulimic symptoms. So it seems to be a more specific relationship for boys than for girls.
And what are some of the other eating disorders that boys could have that are not don't have alcohol that are so transfixed on alcohol?
Yeah, so these other symptoms that we looked at are core symptoms in anorexia nervosa. So bulimia nervosa has that binge eating and the purging component. Anorexia is when you have that low body weight, that drive for thinness, really restrictive eating. So you're eating a very low amount of calories, which causes the low body weight.
And while we're talking about the relationship between alcohol and these, you know, these problems that these eating disorders that young women have, is it that they are alcoholics? Is it that they just use alcohol? What level are we talking about here?
So this study looked at any alcohol use in adolescents, which in and of itself is problematic because we're talking about people that are under 18 years old, right?
They shouldn't be drinking booze in the first place.
Right, they shouldn't be drinking booze. So in that regard, any alcohol use is seen as problematic. So we looked at actually three different levels, and we found that it didn't really matter what level of alcohol involvement you were talking about. So it seems that there's just this generalized risk for risky behavior in these young adolescent populations.
Again, we're talking with Leigh Brosof, who's with the Eating Anxiety Treatment Lab at the University of Louisville, talking about a study that she worked on involving twins, alcohol, and eating disorders. When you talk about these the twins that you looked at, could you figure out why the boys that had bulimia used alcohol or only used alcohol with bulimia, but the girls were much more widespread with any kind of eating disorder problem? Could you figure that out, why that was?
So we don't know exactly why in this study, but some of the reasons that we think is because it seems to be in general that girls have this really generalized risk profile for any eating disorder symptom. So girls seem to have this kind of wider net, we can say. And specifically because this is a genetic study, we're looking at genetic vulnerability for developing these sorts of problems. So girls have a wider net genetic vulnerability for developing this eating disorder symptom, alcohol overlap. For boys, it seems to be more specific in that genetic vulnerability, which kind of makes sense with other things that we see in terms of how eating disorders develop in boys and girls over time.
So what role does family history then play for both boys and girls in these A, eating disorders, and B, using alcohol with your eating disorder?
Yeah, that's a great question. And so that's exactly kind of the thought here is, right, is that those genetics, that family history is going to create that vulnerability for that overlap. And so I think that's the important takeaway here is that if you're vulnerable for one thing, it doesn't mean you're only vulnerable for that one thing. It means you're vulnerable for multiple things. So in a family that maybe has some alcohol history, you may see that wider genetic vulnerability, and it's not specific to alcohol. It's not specific to eating disorders.
And if I'm a parent of a teenager, what should I be looking for?
That's a great question, too. So with eating disorders, any sort of dieting behavior in an adolescent is a serious risk factor for developing an eating disorder. So you really want to talk to your adolescent about dieting, healthy eating, and what actually is a healthy portion for an adolescent to be eating. And then, of course, that proper education around alcohol use. But really, the big takeaway also here is that if you see an adolescent with one problem, it's really important to ask them about other areas of their life too, because it could be generalizing. So if you have a teenager who's experiencing some dieting, are they also using alcohol? Are they also engaging in other risky behaviors? And vice versa, right? So again, it's not just going to be one thing. You're going to see these problems really cast a wider net.
Talking with Leigh Brosof from the Eating Anxiety Treatment Lab at the University of Louisville. And when the parents are noticing, perhaps, that their kid wants to go on a diet, they're thinking, well, you know, kid's a little chunky. Maybe he really needs to go on a diet. Is that A, okay? And then B, does it only become a serious issue if you see them with some other behavior? If you see them, you catch them coming home drunk one night. I don't know. What do you tell parents?
Right. So what we would say is that what you really want to encourage instead of dieting is healthy habits. So, you know, is your kid involved in sports? Are they exercising regularly? Are they eating 5 fruits and vegetables a day? So instead of focusing on, oh, you need to cut things out, you need to diet, it's what are your habits? And really encouraging your teenager to develop those healthy habits, because dieting doesn't work. And actually, it's really detrimental most of the time. So if you have a concern about your child's health, talk to their pediatrician, see what you can come up with in terms of a healthy lifestyle plan. But a diet, it just won't work, and it's only increasing your risk for eating behaviors that are unhealthy. And then in terms of warning signs, I would say any warning sign. You don't need to wait until your kid is coming home drunk. You know, anything that indicates a potential problem, that's a start of a conversation to have, and making sure that you're catching it kind of before it becomes more serious.
And if you have bulimia, if a child has bulimia or anorexia nervosa, either it's genetic driven or they just got essentially depressive symptoms, aren't those the same as what an adult would have?
Yes. So at that point, once you're meeting a full clinical threshold for an eating disorder, for bulimia nervosa, for anorexia nervosa, for binge eating disorder, or one of the other eating disorders, at that point, it's the same symptoms as an adult, and you need to seek specialty care for that eating disorder, because at that point, it's pretty serious.
All right. Final notes on this study and what you do at the clinic?
I think what I would say is the big takeaway is that every person, regardless of gender, regardless of age, regardless of any other characteristic, can have an eating disorder, and that these things don't only occur in isolation.
All right, Leigh Brosof, appreciate you being on the show again. Thanks for listening to UofL Today with Mark Hebert, and go Cards!